You need to be looking on the bright side of life, don't you, with the weather at the moment?
It is horrific, particularly in three states who are right now in the eye of a dangerous weather system. So sandbags are lining the streets of small towns in Victoria. As we go to air, severe weather warnings stretch across most of the state. Further north in New South Wales, authorities have urged people to steer clear of floodwaters after two people needed to be rescued in Forbes. Tasmania also bracing for impact, up to 300 mils of rain forecast to fall in a single day.
300 mils. Boy, oh boy. Our reporting team is standing by. First, Isabella Sashkowski in the town of Rochester in Victoria's north. Is a residence busy preparing there this morning?
Carl, good morning. They certainly are. This is one of the places where residents are sandbagging. I'm going to bring in the commander of the SES, Tim. Tim, you've been on the job for 1 week. You say that by Saturday we're going to be knee-deep in water if we're standing here. How are you feeling this morning?
A little bit apprehensive. Not as apprehensive as some other town residents that lived through 2011 and know exactly what to expect, because I was not here. So it's, I don't know how bad it's actually going to get. All predictions are that, yeah, where we're standing could be up to your knees by Saturday lunchtime when the river peaks.
We're looking at these guys sandbagging. It's a huge community effort. You said, you know, 75 yesterday, 50 today. How amazing is that everyone's coming out to help each other?
Yeah, quite amazing. And we were very thankful of the people that were here yesterday helping. We managed to do 9,000 sandbags from this location yesterday morning. For the whole day yesterday, 9,000 bags.
But it's likely there'll be about 20,000 bags that will be filled?
Yes, we're anticipating filling another 12,000 today because we're running two different sites. So we'll, yeah, should be able to get through the 12,000 today. And hopefully by the end of today, that should be everyone have enough sandbags. We've tried to give them enough notice to get prepared early, which is more than we had in 2011 by all accounts. So the message we're trying to get out to the community is check how high, bag it, block it, lift it, leave. Evacuate early, evacuate yourself if you're not feeling comfortable. Check on your neighbours, make sure they can get out, because once that water comes up, all roads in and out of this town will be cut.
Tim, thanks so much for your time this morning. A huge community effort going on here, guys, and so much more work to be done. But right now there are 700 homes that there are fears for. As you can see, these guys are hard at work. We've got more sand coming in right now. It's all just starting here in regional Victoria.
OK, thanks for that, Izza. And Christina Hearn is in Melbourne. Chris, roads are already starting to flood.
Yeah, they are, Ali, and the Department of Transport is describing driving conditions across Victoria this morning as extremely hazardous. So I can tell you that water is already over the road on the Melba Highway, Hume, Calder and Maroondah highways. And, of course, that is only going to get worse during the day. I can also tell you, just received word that the V line on the Albury line has been suspended due to the extreme conditions. So coaches are replacing trains because of this heavy rainfall. The SES has so far received 438 calls for help in the last 24 hours. Most of that is for flooding and also sandbagging. The worst hit areas so far, according to the SES, is Bendigo and Seymour. Now, here in Melbourne, we're expecting the worst of it this evening, so about 5, 6pm into the night, and then easing by tomorrow morning. Now, that, of course, is during the evening peak. So authorities are really warning motorists to be on high alert and, of course, not drive through any floodwaters. We have had steady rainfall kind of through early morning, but I can tell you just in the last half hour or so, it has really started to pick up. But the Weather Bureau says that this rainfall is going to be worst in the northern suburbs. So they're going to receive up to 60 millimetres of rain today, the western suburbs up to 40 millimetres, not so much in the eastern suburbs. But once again, the worst is yet to come. The significant rainfalls here in Melbourne later this afternoon into the evening. Ali?
It'll be big. Thanks, Chris.
Yeah, big worry across country, Victoria. Our thoughts with you over the next few days. Well, now to a Nine News exclusive. Pardon me. A chaotic scene's unfolding on a Jetstar flight when a brawl broke out mid-air. Check this out. That is crazy. Mia Glover is at Brisbane Airport. Mia, you have new information on what started the brawl.
I sure do, Carl. Good morning again to you. It turns out that one of the men involved in that brawl was actually kicking the seat in front of him, and that's what sparked this chaos, according to one passenger that we've spoken to this morning. But what a frightening ordeal for everybody on board, passengers and staff. It was 24 minutes into the flight from Melbourne to Brisbane on Tuesday night when this chaos started to unfold. Those two men, you can see, started brawling in the aisle and then in the seats as well. You can see them throw punch after punch, blow after blow, passengers trying to intervene. Staff too were trying to intervene, but nothing could be done for a few minutes or so. Thankfully, staff managed after that few minutes to get in between those men and escort one of the men back to the rear of the aircraft. He suffered a bit of a bloodied face. But then passengers told Nine News of their frightening moment when the plane started to descend rapidly, and they say they had no idea what was going on.
Where are we going to land? How are we going to come down? And we were getting no information. So it was incredibly unnerving. By this stage, I'm clutching onto my son.
Turns out that pilot, Carl, was making a priority landing back to Melbourne Airport. Thankfully, they managed to land with no issues. AFP came on board and escorted the two men off the plane. They have told me this morning that the two men weren't known to each other and they haven't been charged.
Over kicking a seat. More on that later. Mia, thank you.
Bali bombing commemorations have come to an end in Kuta this morning, but an Australian survivor has slammed the vigil as traumatic. Damien Ryan is in Kuta for us. Damo, video of the bombers was shown.
Yeah, Lee, I don't think that man is alone. It was a day of services, and possibly the hardest was late last night at Ground Zero, a candlelight vigil just in those moments after 11 p.m. when the bombs actually went off. 20 years ago outside the Sari Club and inside Paddy's Bar. Then the organisers chose to show a 10-minute documentary on the attack on the big screens there at the Bali Memorial site. It was full on, the bombs and the carnage. Then they showed the images of the bombers and that bomb maker, Patek. We know about him. He's due to walk free very shortly after having his 20-year sentence slashed by half. Now, people there that night didn't want to relive the events. They didn't want to see it, and they certainly didn't want to see them.
The focus should have been on them, on this memorial behind us, not having Umar Patek and other terrorists paraded as some heroes. I actually walked away from here towards the Sari Club area because I just didn't want to see it.
Well, countries do things differently, we know that, but the general feeling here at the moment is they certainly got it badly wrong. So the anniversary is over for another year, but not everyone, it seems, is rushing back. Many people we spoke to, many of the Australians we spoke to, still see this place as paradise. They intend to hang around for a few days, have a holiday before heading home. Ali?
OK, thanks, Damo.
Australia is expected to offer Pacific Island nations unprecedented defence support along with potential military integration before a meeting with Papua New Guinea this week. It comes as nearly three dozen Solomon Islands police officers prepare for a training program in China.